Yes.
Good, because tonight's star, which is this afternoon's star, is also an international award-winning actress. And what you might not know about her just yet is that she's also a former United Nations Goodwill Ambassador and also a renowned director, producer, and author. So, Majestic Princess, please welcome Miss Linda Gray.
Yes.
Miss Linda Gray, everyone. Are you happy to see her? And here she comes. She's on her way out now. Please give her a huge round of applause and a warm, majestic princess welcome. So I'm passing the baton over to you, lovely. Please get comfortable. And there we go. We're so happy to have you here on board, really.
I'm thrilled to be here.
Oh, isn't this remarkable, really? We don't ever get opportunities like this on a cruise ship, really, of all places. And I do know that it's been a bit of a wonder to get you backstage today. Did you get lost?
We got lost. And we were downstairs, you know, the doors were locked, and I was like, oh my God.
Yeah, because those were the crew members' cabins. That's why.
How can we get up here?
Well, we got here eventually, and we're very grateful that you are here. But folks, also just down on deck number 5 by the Lotus Spa area. And I'm sure we've all got lost down there as well, right? There we go, pretty standard. Now, Linda, a very warm welcome to you once again. I know that you have so much to share with us here today, so we're going to be diving right in. Because I have found out very recently that when you're about 20 years old, you were very bluntly rejected by a magazine editor as a model. So can you maybe just elaborate on that rocky start for you?
I know, people are always talking about, you know, rejection and how difficult it is. I was 20 and I applied for the Glamour Girl of the Year to Glamour Magazine. I sent in my photograph and I was excited to get the letter in the mail. And what happened was I did get my letter, and it said, thank you for submitting your photograph to Glamour Magazine for the Glamour Girl contest. However, with a little bit of help with your hair and your makeup, you may turn into something. And I was devastated. I thought, oh, it's one person's opinion. She's devastated me anyway. So I have it framed on my desk to this day, sitting there so that I can remember how it was to be rejected. But it was only one person's opinion, the editor of Glamour Magazine. Did I care? Nope. There's another part of it that when I wrote my book, the editors loved that story. And they said, we want to put that in your book about the first time we were rejected. I said, okay, so we had to find the editor.
Yeah.
She was 90 years old. She was fabulous. She was living in Idaho. And we contacted her and said, do you think we can use that quote? Oh, honey, I never wrote that.
Of course you're saying that now.
I loved her to this day. Yeah, she was
in
great.
In hindsight. But yeah, look at you now, really. Just one way to stick it to the people that don't think that you're going to make it, right? So let's give her a big round of applause. Why not? But we do also know that age-old saying about getting your foot in the door to start your career. But Linda went a step further, and she got both of her legs in the door as well. So to give you a bit of a hint, here we go, DJ. Let's hit it. Shout out if you think you know it. I hear Mrs. Robinson over here as well.
Yes.
So you got it. And that was from that great film.
Yes, it was The Graduate.
The Graduate of all things.
And it was 1963 maybe. And a dear friend of mine who is a wonderful photographer, he called me one day and he said, I need you to come to the studio. I just need a couple of shots, blah, blah, blah. I ran over there and he told me that he just needed my legs. I thought, well, that's kind of weird. Okay, had my legs. Okay, so I did the shot and I got paid. And I was so excited. Yeah, I was just a young model. And so he said, well, you know, we're going to pay you for this. I was like, thank you, just for my legs. So anyway, it turned out I made $25, $12.50 a leg. So that was big success in those days.
But it's a good start, I think, for sure. I mean, I honestly have no idea about that story. But if you're looking at this as well, you can't spell the word legendary without the word leg. And that was the start of a very legendary career. So you know
what,
good for you.
Yes, that I don't think it had anything to do with the poster, but I was invited to come to London in the West End and play Mrs. Robinson at the Gielgud Theatre in London. And I said, I'll be there, legs and all.
Legs and all. You were the original legs as well, which is brilliant. So. Now, after The Graduate and being on stage in London as well, I know that that's when Dallas came about as well. So this is Dallas. Oh my life.
Wow.
You know, with It Looks to Kill, I think I wouldn't want to get on Sue Ellen's bad side, that's for sure.
No, that's not.
But with that being said, we all know that Dallas was a smash hit out here in the United States, and it was pretty much on everybody's TV screens. But what you might not know is the far reach that Dallas actually had worldwide as well. So being from South Africa, it is actually a funny story. Every Tuesday night, all the restaurants would have to close their doors because everyone chose to rather be at home glued to their TVs to find out what on earth was happening on Dallas next. And that was all the way down there in the Southern Hemisphere in a little corner of nowhere, really.
And we're so grateful to this day for all of you people. And I don't know where you all are from, but we're so grateful to all of you. We entertained you, hopefully, and so again, grateful. Thank you for watching.
No, thank
you. No, you weren't even born.
We're going to get to that in a minute. We're going to cut out of the bag. Oh my gosh. But also in Turkey, just in case you weren't aware, a session of parliament was actually suspended so that legislators could go home and find out who shot JR. Mm-hmm. It's an important episode, of course, but I'm sure that you have so many crazy stories about that, about fans from around the world and just their reaction to you and your time on that show.
And still, to this day, you know, even on the elevator here on the ship, you know, people are talking and telling great stories. I love the stories. I'm sitting with grandma on the couch and, you know, every Friday night or whenever, I don't know where it was in your country, but those stories are so, so special.
They really are, and that's something that you keep forever. Yeah. So we're very grateful to you as well, Linda, for the part that you played in that. But now back to your career very quickly, because you were a major trailblazer for women in the 1980s, fighting to break into Hollywood's boys' club. And for a chance to direct on the show that you were so instrumental in making such a huge success. But Linda, before you even requested to direct, I know that you did do your homework and you went through a lot of training to make sure that you were ready to go. What was that training like?
Well, it was interesting because Larry and Patrick had already directed on the show. And I didn't want to just say, well, because I'm on the show, I want to direct, and I would be, you know, given that opportunity. So I decided to work with a wonderful woman director. She was French. Her name was Lillian Chauvin. And I said, okay, I want you to teach me how to do it properly. I want to know all the details so that when I go and ask if I can direct, that I'll be prepared. So she taught me. I was working with her on the weekends, and we had a great, great rapport. So anyway, I felt that, you know, I was ready, but I asked her, do you think I'm ready? after knowing all the camera angles, how to do the script, etc., etc. So she said, "You're ready." I said, "Okay, let's do it." So I it came time for that time to negotiate.
And did you feel ready at the time as well?
I did. I was a little nervous, of course, but I felt ready.
And I think nerves in that sort of situation is always a good thing. The adrenaline always does help you there. And as you just mentioned, your contract was up for negotiation at the time. And you said that you didn't want an increase in salary, but you simply wanted to direct one episode, just one. And the response was quite shocking, wasn't it?
I was fired.
What? No.
Yep. Yes. Mm-hmm. I was fired. Because they said, "Well, no, we'll give you money." They said, and this was the weird part, they said, "If you direct, all the other women on the show will want to direct." Yeah.
Again, going back to old Hollywood Boys Club, right?
Yes. And so I went to all the other women that wanted to direct. And I said to Barbara Belgettis, "Do you want to direct?" And she said, "Hell no." And I went to Victoria and to Charlene and asked all the women on the show if they wanted to direct. And there was a resounding no. So I trotted back in there and I said, I asked the women and they said no. I still was fired. So I went home and drove home at the end of that season. I think it was season 8 or something. And Larry called me. He said, "Well, see you next year, sweetheart, you know."
Yeah.
And I said, "Larry, I was fired and I'm sad. And you know, it's anyway," he said, "What do you mean? Hell, you know, J.R. Ewing. What do you mean? What the hell are you talking about?" Anyway, it was, he said, "Well, you can't be fired." He said, "You know, what am I going to do without you?" Mm-hmm. He would have been fine. He would have been fine without me. But thank God he really came to my rescue. And he said, "If she goes, I go."
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
You're used to having, you know, it's sad that it had to be like that, that I didn't, you know, wasn't honored to tell my own, but no. So I did get to direct my one show in 52 shows. That was my negotiation. And there were 52 shows. I didn't think asking for one show was out of line, but I got it. And then I got the script. And the script, if you all remember Dallas, usually there were two people in a scene, two people in an office, in a restaurant, in a bed, et cetera, et cetera. Two people. My script was a costume ball on the island of Martinique with Gurney, our live German Shepherd dogs, everyone in costume. And I thought, okay, I know what you're doing. I know you're trying to bury me. You're gonna just kill me with this script. And there were no two people anywhere,
no,
except the two dogs. You know? It was like, oh my God. And so I thought, okay, deep breath. I know what they're doing, and they just don't want me to direct. But I did. And I did it well.
Yes,
and
you did.
I mean, I was so excited to get my one job, and I thought, you know what, this is not okay. Now, this was in the 80s, and it was not okay for them to, you know, discriminate. And so then I went on every talk show and promoted the hell out of that show. And from then on, I got 5 more episodes to direct.
And that's how it's done. That, even with all of those obstacles that were deliberate, it seems, to be put in front of you to make your directing debut that much more difficult. You obviously weren't getting the support that maybe we needed from the higher-ups, but it does seem that you had a lot of support from your cast members as well. And Larry had a very special gift for you on your first day of directing, right?
Yes. And there was, see, wait a minute, it's the next slide, I think. And that's a cute picture.
There it is. Oh, it was that one. Let's go back one.
It was the one before.
This one.
Yes. Thank you. It was a megaphone that he had made, and I have it to this day. And it was signed by the entire cast and crew because they were so excited that I actually did it and succeeded. And that's a treasure in my life. So.
And have you still got it today?
Yes, I have it.
Yeah, today. You still got it right there back
at home. I send things.
Yeah, as you should, especially for something like this. And I think that sort of message really resonates because you were family, not just on set, but you're a family now in life as well.
Oh, we continue. We're still family. I think maybe somebody, my family, maybe somebody here. Charlie, I can't see, so we have Charlene down here, we have Charlene up there, Christopher up there.
Yeah, hi guys.
Is that Chris? I don't know who else, but I see this is my family. It's Cherie and her husband Vince and Charlene. But we, you know, I've known Charlene since she was 17, and now she's a proud grandma. That's how long our family has been going on.
And I think, you know, going back to your directing debut and then getting awarded the 5 extra episodes as well, I think, did it feel like you had won a victory, not just for yourself, but to help lead the way for future female directors that have now come walking in your footsteps as well?
I think so, you know. I didn't do it for anything other than I knew what I wanted and I was not going to give up and not have people tell me, I can't do anything. It's like, really?
That's
their opinion. I have my own opinion. So that's how I keep
And that's
going.
From day one as well. So good for you. But I know that this might be a lesser known fact for some of us, but equally impressive as well, that Linda was also a trailblazer when you appeared in that series as well, All That Glitters.
Yes. I've been blessed all my life. And one of the beginning blessings was a series that I did for Norman Lear. And Norman Lear and Dennis Weaver, those were the two men in my life that started me on this path. Mm-hmm. And Norman was, and he's still alive, he's 101, I think. But he was a trailblazer, and I've always seemed to work with trailblazers, and he and even Dennis Weaver, who they were my family. Beautiful people, but very much, All That Glitters was very much ahead of its time. So it's kind of like, that seems to be the way I do things. I don't know.
You're leading the way by example.
Yeah, exactly. And I had such great support from both of those men. So it was a wonderful way to start. Sometimes people have a rough time in Hollywood. And I had a loving, a really embracing start by these two men.
And talking about that warm embrace that you had, also then on the cast of Dallas, you played alongside the man that everyone loved to hate, Larry Hagman. But unlike that tumultuous relationship that you had on screen, you were, in fact, really good friends in real life. So tell us about the real Larry.
Ooh, the real Larry. He was my best friend for 37 years. And it was absolutely magic because in the beginning, Sue Ellen Ewing was never to be important in the show. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of, my first line was, more coffee, JR. And that was it. I was kind of known as the brunette on the couch. I didn't have many lines. Nobody knew who I was. I could have been the tennis pro or the masseuse or something. And they never intended us to be important. It was always Bobby and Pamela. But then there was this magic that happened. It was like a chemistry. And we were like bad brother and sister that magically started fighting. It was like, it started to sizzle and CBS saw it. And all of a sudden it was like, ooh, they're interesting. And I remember one of the very first scenes, Larry came out of the bedroom or something, and he said, "Sue Ellen, look at this. There's a button is off my, you know, fell off my shirt." And I said, "I don't sew buttons." And it was like, "Oh, this is going to be fun." And from there, it just kind of went. Yeah. And the magic started.
And Sue Ellen blossomed from that relationship.
Well, it was the two of us. Mm-hmm. You know, it was this magical connection. and he would do something or say something, and I thought, who would marry this guy? Who would marry this guy? Not me. So it started, and it just built and built and built, and the writers loved it, and on we went.
And I think everyone fell in love with that relationship as well, the on-screen. But also with Larry in his real life, he was big into philanthropy as well.
Yes,
that right?
Very much so. And you know, he was all of the things that you didn't see on camera. And he was generous. He was a party. Mr. Hagman, as he liked me to call him, not Larry, he wanted me to call him Mr. Hagman. So I kind of accommodated him when I felt like it. Anyway, Mr. Hagman was put on the planet for a party. He was the leader. He made everybody here. If he was here right now, all of us would get up and we'd follow him around the ship. He'd be holding flags from everywhere, every country that you're from, and we'd all follow him. He was the Pied Piper. He was magic. And he loved people, and he loved making every single occasion bigger than life. And that's who he was.
Sounds
bigger
like
than
me,
life.
Yeah.
Generous, charming, adorable, all those things.
And did you stay in contact for a long time after the show?
Oh yes, you know, after the original show was over, Patrick and Larry and I always met for lunch once a month, and we would just kind of catch up on each other's lives. And then we got a call 20 years later from CBS saying, we're thinking of bringing Dallas back. And it was like, what?
Whoa.
20 years later, that doesn't happen in life.
Well, it did for you.
It did.
And I know that the first series of Dallas aired from 1978 to 1991, and we had a bit of a giggle there because that's the year that I was born. Just in case anyone was wondering.
I didn't catch you.
But to be fair, in South Africa, we're about 5 years behind everyone else. So I know very well what Dallas is all about. My family are huge fans. But also, after Dallas, you went to star in other major TV shows as well. And this is where I recognize you, from Melrose Place. Because I used to watch that with my mum. We used to sit together
thank
on the couch and watch that, like, religiously. Mm-hmm. And then also Models, Inc. was a big one for you as well, as well as an array of other films and TV movies.
Yes.
But in 2012, TNT did bring back that show, and you reprised your role of Sue Ellen. But what was it like having to come back those 20 years after the original show? You had thought that it came to its conclusion. What was it like coming back?
It was wonderful and exciting, and Larry and Patrick and I called each other saying, we get to play together again 20 years later. And that's what it was. It was like playing, because we were like, they called us the Three Musketeers, which was so much fun. And we did. We had the most glorious, fun time together. And to reprise that role again 20 years later, it's like, oh my God, do I know how to be Sue Ellen? I think so.
And do you believe that Sue Ellen's character grew in that time as well?
I did, because I did a lot of research, and I thought, wait a minute, she's grown. She doesn't drink anymore. She doesn't do this. She doesn't. But how am I going to make her be on a par with J.R. Ewing? She knew all the tricks. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, aha, how am I going to do it? So I went to the writers who with a woman writer, woman producer, which was another bonus. And I said, Cynthia, I think she should run. Sue Ellen should run for governor, because that would be like something that JR could, you know, back and forth. They'd have some more chemistry. And she said, okay, let's do it. Well, then they told me, I was having fun with that. And then she said, you know, you've got to lose, because the capital of Dallas is in, it's not here, it's not in Dallas, and we can't afford to keep flying you back and forth.
Yeah.
So she said, you have to lose. I said, okay, but make it quick. Don't make it a long, drawn out, painful thing. Literally.
Pull it off like a band-aid. Yeah. Exactly.
Perfect. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So, that's what happened.
And then after that reunion, in a sense, you were actually with your co-stars Larry Hagman and Patrick Duffy for another 3 seasons of Dallas there. And that's also remarkable to come back after such a long hiatus, in a way, to come back for 3 more seasons. It's beautiful.
It was fun, but it ended too soon.
Mm-hmm,
and
I
think it was a political thing, and I don't even want to know what happened. Anyway.
But Linda, coming back to your craft as an actor, it is very well documented, everything that you have been through, but your commitment to giving back to the community is also something that's so vitally important, and that's very clear, as you have served as a United Nations Goodwill Ambassador for 10 years, from 1997 until 2007, focusing on promoting women's rights. But what did all of that work as the ambassador entail for you?
Well, I was I'm very honored to be invited to work with the UN. And my job was women and children's health issues globally. So I got to go to these little villages, Nicaragua and Malawi, and see how they actually function day to day, what they eat, how they live as a family. And it was staggering, because to hear about it and to read about it is one thing, but to be there and watch these little children and the way they deal with the food and the family dynamics, it was just, my life changed. It was just like, oh my God, how is this possible? How can we better make their lives a bit better without walking in and saying, well, we're the UN.
I see.
Yeah, let's start right over here with Moises.
I don't have a specific question. What I want to say is that you look as beautiful today as you did then.
Yes.
Right? And over here in the front.
Hi, Linda.
Hi.
How many original cast members from the start finished the show? I want to say four, but it could be three, depending on, you know, Bobby died and Bobby came back. So, okay, yeah.
That's magic.
Maybe clear that up. Was Bobby's death originally, were they going to bring him back, or was that just brought on later on?
Well, that was an interesting story because it's a long story, but I'm going to make it really short. Larry called Patrick Duffy and said, let's come out to my home in Malibu and we'll have a drink and we'll talk. Well, Larry wanted the show to remain how it was, and the two brothers, the good brother and the bad brother, were, you know, if it wasn't there, it would lose the magic of the brother thing. So Larry actually negotiated him to come back. Which was a great thing because, and then after that, CBS said no cast member dies again because it costs them $1 million to bring him back. So, you know, no cast member died anymore. Let's see, Jim Davis passed, Barbara Borgettis passed, Ken Kershaval passed, Larry passed. That might be it. So sad to have our cast members pass. But let me see, so that's it. So Charlene and Steve Keneally, who played the cowboy. Let me see, Ken's gone, myself, and Patrick. I think those are the four remaining. Charlene, if you can remember. Okay. I think that's it. Pleasure.
Thank you. All right, I know that we had a hand pop up over here as well. Anybody have a question down here in the front? Oh, right here. Yes, Bob.
I do want to say you are stunning. But I also have a question.
Yes.
During the JR Whodunit, I remember it well, over the summer, it was the talk of the town. Was the cast aware of Whodunit?
I was. I'll tell you the story. Because it was, the writers had a meeting, how were they going to end the season. And so one of the writers said, well, we're just gonna kill the bastard. it's the quote. And so they had no idea that it was going to cause this global phenomenon. So, anyway, they figured out who was going to do it. And that was just how to end that particular season. So our producer said to me, Linda, you go in a recording booth, and here's what you say. And I was told what to read. It was Kristen, it was you who shot JR. Okay. So I knew what I wrote. I mean, what they wrote, I knew what I said, and I recorded it. That's when the actors went on strike, and we had this long summer. So I had to hold that news all summer long when the world went crazy wanting to know who shot JR. So if any of you have a secret that you want to be totally taken care of, tell me, because I don't tell anybody. So I knew months and months before it was announced. I did know because I did it. And if you watch that episode, it was Who Shot JR? And when I said it, it was like, okay, I know. I just can't tell anybody.
No, I don't know how you kept the secret for so long. But Moises at the top there, yes?
That's beautiful.
Oh, yeah. Hi, in the middle.
Should I stand up?
No, you're fine.
Okay. I wanted to say that you're my favorite character in Dallas. Hands down. I know Larry was awesome, but without you, the chemistry wouldn't have been the same. It wouldn't have been the same. I just wanted to let you know, and no offense, but you are my favorite woman drunk ever. You played it so well. Oh my God. I wanted to drink. Okay. I love the scene when you were kidnapped and you didn't know what happened. And you talked to JR. You cried. And I noticed that one of the times when JR was so worried about you that he almost regret being the person that he was. But my question is, would you have loved to marry Dusty and had a kid with him and then get back at JR with that and had like some long rivalry between the two families? That's what I wanted to ask you.
That is a question. I feel like we've got a whole new reboot coming up.
Yes.
Oh. That's a lot.
Many questions. I was like, wait, which one do I answer?
Oh,
thank you.
Would you have married Dusty on the show and had children and moved on?
Do you think Sue Ellen would have changed and rather have married Dusty, right?
Yeah, I knew that that could not continue because the show was Larry and I, our relationship, good, bad, or indifferent, a lot of bad.
Yeah.
But you know, on the show, Dusty died in that airplane crash, so that was never to be. Although I loved working with him, with Jared Martin, it was wonderful. But it was never to be because that would have derailed
the
whole show of the Ewing crazy dysfunctional Ewing family. So okay. Even though it would have been a good idea,
yeah, and then have JR kind of win you back, and you know, but anyhow.
All right, so you're a writer, so go write something wonderful.
We need to collaborate here.
Thank you so much for all the years.
You're welcome. Thank you for that.
All right, we're going to pass on to our next question there, but also I just want to reiterate here, we don't ever refer to a lady drunk. She's called a lush.
Okay.
Yeah, luscious. Yes. That's okay. What we say. But I think we have time for one or two more questions because from here, we're actually going to be doing a meet and greet right outside here in the Double Down Bar on deck number 6. So if you are still wanting to come and meet Linda in person, please don't hesitate. Come and get your pictures taken. Come and ask for your questions. But we do have time for two more. So I know Moises is running right at the back over there. Yes. And we have one question over there. And then we'll take one right over here in the front as well. So let's start at the back there quickly.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I really especially thank you for talking about maintaining curiosity and activity to keep you strong and lively. I came on this cruise because I was nearly killed only about 6 weeks ago, and I'm just grasping life again. It's wonderful. Thank you for your encouragement.
Yes.
Thank
you.
All right over here in the front. Yes.
Your book is just a wonderful page turner, and I can't put it down. And the thing it makes me want to ask you could there be a sequel to your book? And what about a movie?
Oh, I never thought of that. I never thought of a sequel, never thought of a movie. No, but thank you.
You planted the seed.
That's very kind of you, and I appreciate you reading the book. You know, it's a tricky one to write about your life, and I enjoyed it very much, but I appreciate that you actually are in the process of reading it. Thank you very much. I have no idea about a sequel or a movie, nothing. I just go from kind of day to day, and we'll see what happens, but it's a good idea. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Now, Linda, I have a final question for you, actually, because that planted a seed in my mind as well. So, Linda, if somebody had to play you in a movie of your life as Linda Gray,
yes.
Who would you want it to be?
Me.
Oh. And that is a perfect answer. So, folks, please keep that applause going one final time for Linda Gray. But again, we will be just down over there. And don't forget that tomorrow at 2 o'clock, we do also have Cherie, Charlene, and Christopher all joining us up here for a lovely chat as well. So we do hope to see you there. But thank you for coming, and bye-bye. Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Linda. Bye.